Okay, well then we'll begin with today's installment, which is the, as you can see, the Second Seminole War, which occurred in the modern state of Florida back when Florida was just a territory between the years 1835 and 1842. So I did want to begin by just making sure everybody knows that when the first Europeans made landfall in what became the state of Florida eventually, there were no what anybody would call Seminoles there at the time, although native peoples have been living in Florida for at least 12,000 years. So maybe we can see the slide, which should be a map if all goes well. Yes, there it is. So if you look here in the southwestern part of Florida, right about there where that pink shaded would eventually be a county is, that's where at the time the Spanish landed in the 1520s, there were tens of thousands of Calusa Indians, and they were expert fishermen who lived in these vast communal houses built on stilt in the rivers and the creeks of that part of Florida. And some of those houses held sometimes as many as 1,000 people. They were so complex. They were the ones who killed Ponce de Leon when he landed there in 1521 in the neighborhood of what is now Port Charlotte. And to the north, more or less where Jacksonville is and a little bit to the west of Jacksonville, live the Tomucas, also a bit to the south of Jacksonville. And there are at least 200,000 Tomucas in Florida in the 16th century, famous for their pottery. And since this is Super Bowl Sunday, I thought I'd mention that they were also famous for the ball game they would play. The Tomucas would have this really small ball, it's kind of like that, and there'd be 40 players on each side. And the object was to kick the ball so it hit a post. And if you kicked into the post, you got 1 point. And if you kicked the ball up so it landed in an eagle's nest on top of the post, you got 2 points. off in the panhandle, up in the upper left there, live the Apalachee Indians. And they also played their version of the ball game, as a matter of fact. And their capital was at Anheka, which would eventually become Tallahassee later on. They were related to the Tomuka. And they were very active traders. They had trade networks as far as Oklahoma, from which they would get the copper that they made jewelry out of. So they were a people with far-flung contacts all over the American South in the old Southwest. And their name, Apalachee, is the source of the word Appalachia, because when the Spaniards approached them in the 16th century, they gave the name of all the area to the north of their Appalachia, and the name stuck, as far as the mountains are concerned, at least. And these nations had lived and prospered for many thousands of years. And at one time, at least in the 16th century, there must have been at least 350,000 native peoples in Florida. And that's a population of Florida, 350,000, that the modern state of Florida would not have until the 1880s. So it was a heavily populated place. They had a lot in common, although they spoke different languages. But one of the things that all the peoples of Florida had in common, that they also had in common with the creeks off to the north of them, in what is now Mississippi, Alabama, and Georgia, was that they all drank some version of the black drink, famous to Europeans as the black drink, a heavily caffeinated concoction made from the Yaupon holly plant, known to science for very good reason as Ilex fumatoria. And when the Spaniards arrived, especially the Apalachee, but all the Indians in their own way, defended themselves with great skill for a long time. The Apalachee, for example, learned that if you wanted to defeat a small Spanish detachment that was on the way to raiding your village, the thing to do was to kill the horses first. And then they would aim at the Spaniards themselves with arrows that could pierce two layers of chainmail if aimed exactly right from the exactly right range. So they held out for quite a long time in Florida, but in the end, they were no match for the thing that killed so many Indians at the time: measles, smallpox, malaria. And to those enemies, they had no defense at all. So that from 350,000 people, we think, in the 16th century, there were only about a few hundred left by the middle of the 18th century. So the Calusas, the Tomucas, and the Apalachee had all but vanished by the time of the French and Indian War in the middle of the 18th century. But their tragedy, and a terrible tragedy it was, would be the making of the Seminoles. So before we go any further, because I'll be using a lot of Florida landmarks, probably a lot of you have traveled to Florida, probably have relatives there, so a lot of this will be familiar to you. I just wanted to point, you're not snowbirds because you're here, but I just would like to point out a few things. First of all, around there is where the Red Sox train, Fort Myers, on the Caloosahatchee River. We'll be seeing the Caloosahatchee in a little while. There was some combat there. And then Ocala, really important to our story around there. Tampa, where Fort Brooke would be. is at this part of the state. And we'll also mention the Withlacoochee River. And the Withlacoochee is up here. They'd be fighting there. So around Fort King, Ocala, the Withlacoochee, Fort Brooke, later Tampa here, and the Caloosahatchee here. But we'll get back to another map, don't worry, just in case your memory fades over the next few minutes. But again, because of this horrific series of events, based largely upon European-born diseases, with the traditional Indians of Florida unfortunately mostly gone by the 18th century, that would be the making, as I said, of the Seminoles. What the Spaniards came to call the Seminoles were really a hodgepodge of very different Indian groups who began moving into Florida in the mid to late 18th century, occupying lands that used to be Appalachian or Timucan or Calusan. And some of them were Yamasees from what is now South Carolina, but a lot of them were members of the Creek Nation, which is the name the English gave to a lot of different Indian groups in the old American Southwest, Georgia, Alabama, and Mississippi. So they began to move in to northern Florida and central Florida, in a sense moving into the vacuum created by the mass deaths of the traditional Indians of Florida. The languages they spoke differed widely from each other, but as they began to move into Florida, they began to coalesce into one a specific group of Indians themselves, a new nation, which came to be called the Seminoles. The Spaniards began calling them, and this is how they got their name, the Spaniards began calling them the Cimarrones, which is their word for runaways, Cimarrones or runaways. And that was a word that was very similar, happily similar, to the old Muscogean word Seminoles, meaning those that camp at a distance. So the English would take those two words, the Spanish word and the Muscogean word, and they came to call these Indians of Florida the Seminoles. Over time, the remnants of what were left of the traditional nations of Florida joined them in the communities they were establishing in northern and central Florida. But not only them, also escaped African slaves from the colonies of Georgia and South Carolina, increasingly escaped to the south at a time when the boundary of freedom, which we are usually used to associating with the Ohio River, was actually the St. Mary's River between Spanish Florida and English Georgia. So a number of these escaped African slaves did make it down to join the Seminoles. They became known as the Black Seminoles. And some of them lived as free people adjacent to Seminole communities and associated with them. But some of them signed on voluntarily as slaves to the Seminole Indians. And the reason they did that was because the way the Seminoles looked at slavery was a lot better than the way English colonists looked at slavery. If you were a slave to the Seminoles, you could live on land almost like a tenant farmer. There were no overseers. There were no whips. All you would have to do is pay to your so-called master a portion of your produce every year, and then they would let you alone to live as you like. And that seemed like a better deal than what you would get in Georgia and South Carolina, and so that's why escape was a very good option. And for a century, beginning in the middle or early to mid 18th century, things proceeded more or less favorably for the Seminoles, given the fact that neither the English nor the Spanish showed much interest in settling this place. But then, shortly before 1819, Andrew Jackson, having won many battles during the War of 1812, and in command of American forces in the Old Southwest, decided to invade Florida to punish the Seminoles for taking in these African slaves. And Andrew Jackson was successful in this little invasion, although it was unauthorized by President Monroe, and in the process re-enslaved hundreds of the Black Seminoles who found refuge with the Seminoles of Florida. And that's what history calls the First Seminole War, 1817 to 1818. But Florida at the time was still Spanish. So it was only in 1819 that the United States acquired Florida in return for our agreement to assume $5 million of debt that Spain owed to American citizens. So just like that, a $5 million assumption of debt, Florida became American. Many of the Black Seminoles now figured that under the American flag, their chances of being re-enslaved were now a lot greater. So at this point, a lot of the Black Seminoles actually emigrated south to the Bahamas to live under British rule, and that many of their descendants are there to this day. Others stayed and will play a part in our story, which is about to come. Now, nobody in Washington knew precisely what to do with this new territory. Many Americans thought of it as a place of mosquitoes and flies, with little decent land. There were hardly any roads to speak of in Florida. And aside from Pensacola and St. Augustine, there were no nothing similar to what most Europeans, for example, would think of as a town. However, there were some reasons to believe that Florida was a place that offered some potential for wealth, at least in the long term. Maybe North Florida would be good cotton land. There was some sense about that. And also maybe there was cattle territory, good cattle raising territory in North and Central Florida. And so white settlers began moving in greater numbers after 1819. And many of them believed the best thing to do would be to persuade the Seminoles to perhaps stay in their own area and not bother whites moving in from the north. And so in 1824, the U.S. government persuaded Seminole leaders to sign the Treaty of Moultrie Creek. Now we can go to the next slide. This is a painting of what a typical Seminole warrior might have looked like in the early 19th century. Now we go to the next slide. And as of the Treaty of Moultrie Creek, what the Seminoles agreed to, and it's confusing because for some reason this is in French, but what they agreed to was to remain on this Seminole Reserve here. And you can see it's very large between Lake Okeechobee on the south and over there Fort King, which is now Alcala, to the north. And the idea would be whites from what is now the American South would settle parts of the north, raise cotton, maybe raise cattle, and the Seminoles could go about their traditional life here in the central part of the state. There, the Seminoles would henceforth live. That was the idea, supported by annual subsidies by the U.S. government and watched over by garrisons at Fort Brooke, what is now Tampa, there in Fort King, what is now Alcala to the north. And that resolution might have held for many years, had it not been for the fact that many Southerners were still upset about the Seminoles acting as a refuge for escaped slaves. That was a big deal. And also, had it not been for the natural tendency of cattle to do things that ranchers have been upset about ever since there have been such a thing as ranchers, and that is to wander off. So inevitably, what happened was, as whites began to settle Central Florida to the north there, they began to accuse the Seminoles of taking for themselves stray cattle, and the Seminoles began accusing whites of doing the same thing to their herds. The Seminoles had long been raising cattle in that part of the state, and this conflict began to be the source of a great deal of trouble. And many of the whites of Florida now thought the only thing to do to make sure their cattle was protected and to make sure slaves would not be tempted to run off was to remove the Seminoles from this reserve of theirs and to take them out west, maybe to Oklahoma, where so many Creeks and Cherokees were being forcibly removed to at the same time by the early 1830s. That, at least, was what President Andrew Jackson wanted to do. Jackson was the great supporter, the great apostle of the removal policy. So if the Creeks and the Cherokees were being removed to Oklahoma and Arkansas, why not the Seminoles? And some of the Seminoles did agree through the Treaty of Payne's Landing, it was called, to move west. Some of them signed on to it, but most did not. And the situation was combustible by 1835. The problem was the government wants them to be removed, led by Andrew Jackson, but many of the Seminoles don't want to go. And those who didn't want to go were led by the most famous Seminole of them all. Now we go to the next slide, and if all goes well, there he should be. There he is. That is the great Osceola, who had emerged as the leader of the Seminoles who under no circumstances were going to leave their reserve in Central Florida. He had been born a Creek in Alabama, and since his father was a Scotsman, he went by the name from birth Billy Powell. That was his original name, but his mother was Creek. And in the Creek tradition, your identity always stemmed from your mother, not the father. So by the time he was a teenager and had gone through the ritual known as the Green Corn Dance, which Seminoles do to this day, he was officially a member of the Seminole tribe and began to be called Osceola. And Osceola seems to mean black drink singer, because I guess when he drank a lot of the black drink at first during the Green Corn Dance, he sang in ecstasy, enjoying the experience, apparently. And it is said that Osceola was so opposed to removal, so opposed to leaving Florida, that when he was shown the Treaty of Payne's Landing, by which some of the Seminoles would agree to go, he took a dagger and he put it right through the paper of the treaty. For many years, historians doubted that story. Seems like it's too good to be true. But a modern historian who actually looked at the original copy of the Treaty of Payne's Landing actually saw a little tear where a dagger would have made. So maybe it actually did happen. So on Osceola's urging, the head of the Alachua Seminoles, a man called Micanopy, announced that his people would not go, not going to go. Fighting could now break out at any moment. White settlers throughout northern Florida began picking up to leave, fearing the raids that were sure to come if war broke out. And all of a sudden, the U.S. garrison at Fort King, the small U.S. garrison there, looked very precarious indeed. At least that's what the men at Fort Brooke thought down the road, 100 miles away, in what is now Tampa. Now, there wasn't a whole lot of communication between Fort King and Fort Brooke, but the garrison at Fort Brooke figured those guys probably need help at Fort King. So Major Francis Dade volunteered to lead 110 soldiers to strengthen the garrison at Fort King. Brave thing to do. He volunteered to lead that force. They left on December 21st. And remember, outright hostilities had not broken out yet, but everybody thought they were about to. And they followed on the way to Fort King, northeast from Fort Brooke, what is now U.S. Highway 301. For those of you who travel in Florida, you might know 301. And from the very first day of the march, Seminoles watched them from the adjoining vegetation that lined the side of a pass for the road. But they did not attack. They were waiting for Osceola, who was busy keeping an eye on Fort King. 4 days went by as Major Dade led his little force of 110 men to reinforce Fort King. And they knew the Seminoles were there, but there was no attack. Finally, Micanopy, persuaded that they could wait no longer for Osceola to join them, decided that the time had come indeed to attack on the fifth day. So the Seminoles positioned themselves in some tall grass by the side of the road and waited for Major Dade to march by. Now, Major Dade was now about to commit the cardinal military sin of which so many officers, unfortunately, have been guilty, of planning for what you hope the enemy will do rather than what they might do. Now, he had thought, well, the Seminoles have not attacked yet. That means they're not going to attack. So he did not send out flanking parties to keep an eye on the side of the road. He did not send out scouts to the front. Moreover, because it was cold, he allowed his soldiers to button up their coats so that they would be over the cartridge belts, where, of course, the ammunition was, so that if there was a sudden battle, they would have difficulty actually reaching what they would need to fire back. And so in the early morning hours, in the deep cold, the soldiers passed the concealed Seminoles, barely knowing they were there and ill-equipped to fight back if there was an attack. Micanopy, their leader, was the first one to stand up and fire. And then the rest of his force did the same thing, firing at will, killing over half of Dade's force in the first volley. The fact was that for the only time, one of the only times in all the conflicts between U.S. forces and the Indians, in this conflict here, near what is now Bushnell, Florida, the Seminoles had better weapons than the U.S. Army. Because what the Seminoles had were rifles that they had bought from the Spanish. Excellent at long range, and very good, murderous, in fact, at the short range we're dealing with here. While the U.S. Army only had the traditional flintlock muskets that took longer to load and weren't as accurate. Bravely, as the first volley, decimating as it was, allowed the soldiers a little bit of time to think what was going on, maybe a little bit of time to recover, some of Major Dade's men brought the artillery into position, opened fire. That held the Seminoles back for a little while, but only for a little while. The only thing they could do is try to entrench, maybe build breastworks, maybe try to hold them off that way, but half the force was gone. And the other half were simply too isolated. They couldn't build the breastworks in time. So within really just a few minutes, between a half hour and an hour, the entire force was wiped out. Only two escaped death, and they were really badly wounded. And one of them was a guy named Ransom Clark, who had a broken arm, a broken collarbone, a wounded leg, a bullet in the lungs. But somehow he managed to crawl back to Fort Brooke to let everybody know what had happened. So the entire 110-man force was wiped out, except for two badly wounded survivors. Now, at just about this time, so the story goes, another group of Seminoles tried to surprise the garrison at Fort Gatlin, a bit to the southeast of Fort King, in what was then Mosquito County, Florida. But they were foiled in their attempt when a soldier named Orlando Reeves sounded the warning just in time, only to be killed right afterward. And in recognition of his courage, later residents decided to name the place Orlando. They wanted people to move there, so I think some impressive marketers decided maybe we should change the name of the county from Mosquito County. And they named it Orange County because of that. So that's the story, that naming the place after Orlando Reeves, we have a permanent memory to one of the heroes of the Seminole Wars. The only thing wrong with this story is, as far as we know, nobody named Orlando ever served in the US Army in Florida. There was a landowner nearby named Orlando Reese, but he left the place in 1840, and as far as we know, he never warned anybody. So how did Orlando get its name? The fact is, nobody knows, but this is the best theory that I've read. Not that anybody would be interested in this, but I was. A better theory is that a judge from South Carolina moved into the area in the 1850s, and he was a big Shakespeare fan. And one of his favorite plays was As You Like It, and there's a character named Orlando in As You Like It, so he named the place after the character. That became Orlando, Florida. And that might be the true story, because those of you who know Orlando, one of the main drags is Roosevelt Avenue in Orlando, and so if Roosevelt Avenue is there, it probably does have something to do with As You Like It, and that's probably how it got its name. But we don't know. All we do know is that Dade County, Florida was named after Major Dade, who died in this attack from Micanopy. In the opening days of the Second Seminole War, December 28th, 1835. So now we can continue to the next slide. So Dade was killed December 28th. This is a modern reenactment of Dade's battle amidst the tall grass and the vegetation on the side of the road. They reenact the battle every year. And this is a pretty good rendition of U.S. Army uniforms at the time. I'll say something else about that in a little while. But that would have been something like what the engagement looked like. So on that very same day, the same day of Dade's battle, Osceola killed Wiley Thompson, the U.S. government's main agent for Seminole affairs at Fort King. Wiley Thompson had made the mistake of going for a little walk outside Fort King. Osceola saw him, killed him. There were 14 bullets in his body when they finally found Wiley Thompson. Osceola hated Wiley Thompson, and the reason was that at one point not long before that, Osceola had been imprisoned by Wiley Thompson, and Wiley Thompson actually put him in chains. And Osceola never forgot that experience of being in chains, and he vowed to kill Wiley Thompson, and now he had, now that the war had begun. And the war, in fact, was now on in earnest. But the commander of U.S. forces in Florida, General Duncan Clinch, did not know that yet. Word of the Dade battle had not reached him when he led 750 men towards an area of Seminole country, a little bit to the west and northwest of Fort King. He was approaching the Withlacoochee River, again, west and northwest of Fort King, on New Year's Eve, so only 3 days after Dade's battle. And he found that recent heavy rains had made the ford that he was approaching on the Withlacoochee impassable. What he was trying to do was maybe approach the Seminole Reserve and persuade more of them to remove themselves under U.S. Army auspices to Oklahoma. He thought he could do that with a show of force, and that's why he had 750 men with him. 250 regular members of the Army, 500 volunteers from militia groups. So he's got this broad river that now can't be forded. Not knowing the Seminoles were nearby, what he decided to do was cross the river by taking the one leaky boat available to him and putting members of the Army on the boat and just in shifts, putting them across the river and across the river. But it took a long time, as you can imagine. There's only one boat. So by the time it was dark, there were 250 members of the Army on the south side of the Withlacoochee and 500 militia members on the north side. And the Seminoles were watching the whole thing and waiting for them, led by Osceola, who had just arrived on New Year's Eve. This is, of course, a recipe for catastrophe. You've got a very swollen river between the two parts of your army, 250 on the south bank, 500 on the north bank. Clinch's fate could well have been the same as Dade's. Indeed, in the early morning hours before the 500 men could join the 250 on the south side, the Seminoles opened fire, killing several and wounding a lot of Clinch's force on the south side of the river. In this crisis, Clinch kept his head, ordered a bayonet charge that temporarily drove the Seminoles off, and then, with that respite, he was able to begin the process of getting his men back on the north side. They lost 4 dead, they lost 60 wounded, but they got back to the north side of the river in safety. And New Year's Day, 1836, now dawned with the Seminoles having every reason to believe that they were winning this war. Fort King itself would soon be abandoned. Two major battles had been fought. The Seminoles had every reason to think they had won both of them. And the little United States Army, all 7,000 of them, spread out from the Canadian border all the way down to Key West, now had a major war on its hands. And no one in the U.S. government seemed to have much of an idea about how to win it. For the next year, all through 1836 into 1837, Osceola and the other Seminole chieftains, like Micanopy and a very, very good leader named Alligator, eluded forces led by Winfield Scott and his great rival Edward Gaines, after whom Gainesville is named. We think that at least 350 African slaves escaped during 1836 to join the Seminoles, which is why some historians view the Second Seminole War as the greatest slave revolt in American history. There's some dispute about whether we can think of it that way, but some historians have that contention at least. No one in the Army liked this service, involving, as it did, long and usually fruitless searches for Seminoles through chest-deep waters in Central Florida swamps. And to make matters worse, many Americans sympathized with Osceola, who, after all, was doing nothing but fighting for the freedom of his people in a place where they've been living for about a century now. Some newspapers even applauded Osceola for an audacious raid in the neighborhood of Fort Brooke, in which she freed 700 Seminoles who were being detained there awaiting transport to Arkansas and Oklahoma. By the beginning of 1837, many were souring on this war in the U.S. government. By then, Andrew Jackson was out of office. He was always the one most in favor of removal. Now he's gone, and the new president, Martin Van Buren, had a new crisis to worry about in the panic of 1837. The country was in the midst of a terrible depression. Government receipts were way down. The treasury was running out of money. How could this war possibly be worth it under those circumstances? Maybe the time had come to look for a peaceful solution. And ironically, popular feeling in the United States against this war were only aggravated by what looked to some like a major victory. In the spring of 1837, the latest American commander in Florida, General Jessup, began putting out peace feelers. Maybe the time had come to seek a deal. Maybe the Seminoles could be encouraged to negotiate an end to this conflict. Osceola resisted the idea for a while. But then in October of 1837, he agreed to meet one of the American officers outside St. Augustine to just talk about it. And General Jessup had an officer, General Hernandez, who was deputized to speak to Osceola. And of course, there was a flag of truce. So Osceola approached the encampment, as did representatives of the U.S. Army. And as the flag of truce flew over the camp, Hernandez asked one question to Osceola: will you lay down your arms? Osceola was not given a chance to answer. At that moment, Hernandez raised his hand, and when he raised his hand, concealed members of the army on either side of the camp rushed in and took Osceola prisoner, along with the best of his co-commanders, a figure named Coacuchi. Now, this was an act of unmitigated treachery, and if anything was going to turn the American people against this war even more than they were already feeling, it was this. Osceola was thrown into jail in St. Augustine and then taken to Fort Moultrie in Charleston Harbor, and by then he was a sick man. One day, only 3 months after his capture, with Osceola in his prison cell, he got up from his cot, he walked over to the little bench where his clothes were kept, he put on his best finery, he walked back to his cot, he laid down, he put his arms around his chest like that, and he died. He was 34 years old. Believe he died of malaria. Now, Coacuchi, by the way, the other man who was taken prisoner, same time Osceola was, did not share Osceola's fate. He was taken to a dungeon in St. Augustine as one door to the cell. And he was there with a fellow prisoner named John Horse, and they're in this cell together. There's only one source of light, and it's a tiny window right on top. And Coacuchi kept looking at that window. Nobody could crawl through the window, but he kept thinking, there's got to be a way to crawl through that window. So here's what he did. He had smuggled in some herbs into the cell by sympathetic, I don't even know if they were Seminoles, but they were native peoples who lived and worked in the encampment. But he got these herbs smuggled in, and the herbs were meant to suppress appetite. They were diuretics. So he kept taking these herbs. He must have suffered terribly, but he began losing weight. And John Horse would do the same thing. So finally, as weak as they were, they got to the point where Coacoochee thinks, I can get through, I'm thin enough to get through that window. So John Horse lifted him up. He got up to the window. He began squeezing through, bleeding profusely. But he got through. And there was some sheets that would act as a rope that were tied to him. So he dropped down head first on the ground. And then John Horse followed up the sheets, and he got through too. He injured his leg badly on the way down, but they both got out, and they both escaped, and they both lived to fight another day. Now we can go to the next slide. Now, the general revulsion following Osceola's death, combined with the sheer expense of this war, should have been enough to make the government decide to call it quits, at least for the time being. That's what General Jessup really wanted. I think he was ashamed of what Hernandez had done in taking Osceola prisoner. In fact, once it was clear that the Seminoles weren't going to give up, despite the capture and death of Osceola, although in this part of the story he hadn't died yet, he'd just been captured, General Jessup decided on his own authority to open up negotiations. And so he invited a bunch of Seminoles in to an area where he could camp next to the Seminoles, and he could go eat with them, and they could go eat with him, and they could talk about maybe what a good settlement of the war would be. So they were negotiating in good faith, and Jessup actually sent word to the Secretary of War in President Van Buren's cabinet, maybe we can work something out. Can you give me some guidelines about what a good treaty would be? But the Secretary of War rejected the whole idea. And now we meet the Secretary of War. We could spend an entire lecture series on him. There he is. That's Joel Poinsett. Joel Poinsett, the Secretary of War under Martin Van Buren, our first minister to Mexico, who gave his name, because he's a botanist, to a beautiful flower that he found there. Now we can go to the next slide. Of course, the poinsettia, which would become very popular in the United States, who established a system of canals in his native South Carolina, one of the great inland transportation systems in North America. Now we go to the next slide. Joel Poinsett, who was instrumental in securing Chilean independence from Spain by helping out the Chilean patriots and freedom fighters when he was our unofficial minister to the South American republics. Joel Poinsett, who along with John Quincy Adams, next slide, deserves to be thought of as the founder of the Smithsonian Institution, who made sure that that money wasn't going to be wasted, we were going to have a great national museum. Joel Poinsett, many good things to say about him, maybe not so much here. Joel Poinsett was an ardent believer in removal of the Indians. So he rejected Jessup's attempt at a compromise, and he actually ordered Jessup, all those Seminoles he'd been talking to, arrest them. Now they were there at Jessup's invitation, but he was now ordered to take them into custody. He didn't want to do it, but he's a general. He was ordered to do so, and so he did. Another incident of treachery that the Seminoles would not forget. And so the war went on. We're now at the end of 1837. Coacoochee had joined forces with the emerging leader of most of the Seminoles, a man named Billy Bowlegs, on the northern shores of Lake Okeechobee. They'd been driven there by an earlier offensive by General Jessup. And approaching them on the north side of Lake Okeechobee was the Army's most experienced general, none other than Zachary Taylor, commanding about 700 regular Army troops and over 100 Missouri volunteers. The military commander of the Seminoles there, along with Billy Bowlegs and Coacoochee, was a masterful tactician named Wildcat. And Wildcat figured, we're going to stand and fight, at least to give the women and children time to get back into the swamps. We'll stand and fight here. He was outnumbered 2-1. But at least the Seminoles had a strong position on a hammock. Which, if you know Florida, a hammock is a small, elevated rise of land that's usually heavily vegetated with trees on it. Pretty good place to make a defensive stand. And Wildcat had found such a hammock, and there the Seminoles were. If Taylor wanted to attack, he would have to do so across what amounted to a field of mud, 3 feet deep. And he's decided to attack, sending in the Missouri volunteers first. There they went. And you can imagine, they were bogged down. It's a horrific way to attack. They were decimated by Seminole fire. Some of that fire, by the way, was coming from trees on the top of the hammock. Zachary Taylor was accustomed to sharing the hardships of his men. That's why it was in this campaign in 1837 that he got the nickname Old Rough and Ready. But he was not with the Missourians as they were cut down. Undaunted, Zachary Taylor sent in the 6th Infantry. They were cut down too. So he sent in the 4th Infantry, and finally the 4th Infantry did better. They were able to grapple with the Seminoles in a flanking attack from the north, eventually forced Wildcat to order a retreat across Lake Okeechobee. Having no boats, Taylor could not follow. It was not much of a victory. Taylor had lost far more men than the Seminoles had, but it was enough to make Taylor famous, and it was on the strength of this battle at Lake Okeechobee, the biggest battle of the whole Seminole Wars, that Zachary Taylor came to the attention firsthand of leading members of the military so that a few years later, when they needed somebody to take command of U.S. forces in Texas in 1845, Zachary Taylor was the man, and the next step was the Battle of Buena Vista, and the next step was the White House. But with the war 4 years old by now, Taylor and Jessup, when you really came right down to it, were no closer to victory than they had been in 1835. The Florida wilderness was too thick, and as long as the Seminoles could make camp in a hammock here and there amidst the swamps, and as long as there was plenty of arrowroot, which was a root that if you just ate it off the ground was toxic, but if you made it into flour was quite nutritious and would provide sustenance for you. As long as that was true, they could hold out, they could feed their families, and they could keep the war going. The army, the American army, now fighting its first genuine guerrilla war, found it difficult to find those hammocks, and when this or that detachment found something to attack, they found that their uniforms, now we can go to the next slide, which you saw a glimpse of before, they were light blue, provided a very good opportunity for Seminole marksmanship, because you see these white stripes? All the Seminoles had to do was aim in the middle of the white stripes. And too often, that would mean danger for these infantrymen. Resistance by the Seminoles, of course, was not easy by any means. But while some of the Seminoles were prevailed upon during the course of the war to emigrate, plenty still refused to go, led by Billy Bowlegs and Colacucci, and another leader named Sam Jones, who during the later stages of the war really began to take precedence. The only Americans who really wanted this war to continue, when he got right down to it, were white Southern slaveholders in white Floridians who wanted to maintain their cattle herds as best they could. The public as a whole was sick of the endless war and all the money it was costing. The panic of 1837 was only getting worse. Jessup was sick of the whole thing. He asked to be relieved. Taylor contented himself with building forts, not really wanting to send men into those swamps, avoiding that whenever he could. So in the spring of 1839, now that President Van Buren had figured that public opinion was dead set against the war, he was now ready to override Secretary of War Poinsett and decide that maybe a treaty was the way to go. So in the spring of 1839, now we go to the next slide, the new American commander, General McComb, there he is, made a deal. The government would not insist on the removal of any more Seminoles. The Seminoles would be left unmolested in a vast reservation to the southwest of Lake Okeechobee, more or less where Port Charlotte, Fort Myers are. That would be the new reservation. They could stay there. They would not be removed. Peace was at hand, and it looked for all intents and purposes as if the Seminoles had won. Sam Jones signed the treaty, and given his prestige among the Seminoles, McComb figured that the rest of the nation would follow suit. Which by now, speaking of the rest of the nation, numbered several thousand. Many white Floridians did not like the deal. One headline in Tallahassee said, "Shame, shame, shame." But that was not the prevailing opinion. The war was ugly, it was expensive, and most were willing to let it go. So I think here it's worth pausing. Note what had just happened. It's 1839. The Seminoles could justly say they won the war. They had won most of the engagements that they had fought, or at least they had given as good as they'd gotten. The new reservation in southern Florida was not as large as the preserve they had before, but it was still quite large. And at least for the time being, those who didn't want to go to Arkansas and Oklahoma were not going to be made to go. If the war had indeed ended here, as McComb wanted it to end, and as most of the Seminoles wanted it to end, the Seminoles might have had a chance to live in that area for decades to come, to grow and prosper as a people, an area, by the way, that for a long time would not be of great interest to white settlement, so that by the time Florida really began to grow in the early to mid-20th century, the Seminoles might have been so well established there that they could have preserved their power through traditional political efforts, both in Washington and in Tallahassee. They could have held their own, and history might have been much different. That could have happened. But it didn't happen. And the reason had to do with a group of Seminoles who had not signed this treaty with Macomb, and who did not follow Billy Bowlegs or Sam Jones. And their leader was a man named Chikaika. Not only had he not signed the treaty, but after what had happened with Hernandez in capturing Osceola, and what had happened with Jessup being ordered to take those Seminoles prisoner, even though he invited them to his camp, Chikaika believed that the U.S. government was not as good as its word, and that he couldn't trust the U.S. government, and that, in fact, this is at best a truce, and that the thing to do was to strike back before Seminoles could be attacked again. So Chikaika, on his own authority, decided to attack a U.S. trading post on the Caloosahatchee River. If you know what Fort Myers is, this is right across the Caloosahatchee from Fort Myers. It was a little post that had just been established, protected by a little detachment of 23 American soldiers under the command of one Colonel Harney. And Colonel Harney had asked General McComb for more men, but none had arrived, at least not yet. A few months after the treaty was signed, about 150 of Chikaika's Seminoles attacked the post in the dead of night. Most of the U.S. soldiers there were killed in their beds. Harney, luckily for him, was not in the camp at the time, and along with a couple of others, he managed to escape down the Caloosahatchee. Some of the soldiers were killed after they were surrendered, and some civilians have been killed too around the trading post. And predictably, when news of that got out, there were demands for retribution, demands for revenge. The war was on again. Zachary Taylor was still in Florida. He had no stomach for the fight now that the war was on again. McComb really had no stomach for the fight. He has to be relieved. So a new general arrived in Florida, and the war was now about to end under his auspices. Now we go to the next slide, and his name was General Keith Armstead. And Armstead believed, as was certainly true, that this is first and foremost a different kind of war. We call it a guerrilla war. So he decided to fight it along those lines. Whenever possible, he sent small detachments into the swamps to burn whatever Seminole crops and food supplies they could find. And they did so in the high summer. Usually the Army didn't like to fight in Florida in the high summer, for obvious reasons. But Armstead believed that that's when the crops were grown. That's when the Seminoles got the nutrition that they needed to go on. So that's when you had to go into their areas and destroy whatever they could find. For the first time in the war, under Armstead's leadership, the American forces really learned to fight using guerrilla tactics. This is the first guerrilla war in the history of the U.S. Army. They would strike quickly, in keeping the Seminoles off balance. They would use their tactics as well. They would fight from tree to tree, as the Seminoles often did. And they stopped wearing those sky blue uniforms with the white cross hatching. Armstead would allow his soldiers to wear almost anything they wanted on campaign. And to make matters even more favorable, he was never reluctant to bribe Seminole leaders to be removed. So a combination of bribery, guerrilla tactics, fighting from tree to tree. And also, it's only fair to point out, for the first time in the Indian Wars, really for the only time, the U.S. Navy was a vitally important element. So naval personnel began moving into the swamps on boats like this and helping to seek out those hammocks where the Seminoles would usually make their stand. So here for the first time was a winning formula for winning a guerrilla war. Learn from the enemy, do what they do, destroy the food supply whenever you can, and bribe leaders into surrender. So within 2 years of the Harney Massacre, the Seminoles were down to just a few hundred warriors. In the spring of 1841, Wildcat, who had fought Taylor on Lake Okeechobee, surrendered to a young lieutenant named William Tecumseh Sherman. And within the year, by the middle of 1842, organized resistance was more or less at an end. Most of the Seminoles, several thousand of them, many of them were already in captivity around Fort Brooke. Others came in and took the offer of removal offered by the Army. They were taken to the Arkansas Territory, and what few remained, perhaps 300, mostly in the Everglades under Billy Bowlegs and Sam Jones' leadership, were no longer considered a threat. After seven difficult years, the Second Seminole War was over, the longest and the most expensive Indian War in American history, costing more money than all the wars against the Plains Indians in the 19th century combined. There would be a third Seminole War, but even after that one, all the Seminoles were not removed. There'd still be a couple hundred left, and those couple hundred are the ancestors of the thousands of Seminoles who live in Florida to this day, those who always refuse to go. And that's why the Seminoles to this day call themselves the unconquered. They do not believe they were ever really defeated by the U.S. Army because they were never completely removed. There are other things to say about the Seminoles, so maybe we can save that for now, our little question and answer. But if anybody has questions or comments about the conflict, we're not going to take a little break, as we sometimes do. Now's the time for you to bring it up. Yes?
You mentioned earlier that the Army used an artillery piece.
Yes.
What good is an artillery if the enemy is spread out over an area? I would think it would only be useful if they're all bunched up together.
Yeah, they only had a few artillery pieces. They certainly are more effective if everybody's bunched together. But the thing about artillery is it can have a very terrifying effect if you're not used to it. Usually in warfare against Indians, no matter how often they had to face artillery, it always had an effect of disturbing their version of what was to follow and their idea of what kind of tactics they were going to use. It did have an effect, at least momentarily, of disturbing their operations. And that was true in the Second Seminole War. It's also true on the plains as well. You can never have that many pieces of artillery out there, of course, but if you had some, it would usually have some at least short-term effect. Yes, go ahead.
What year was the guerrilla war?
Well, the real guerrilla phase of the war, 1839 to 1842.
I'm thinking of the Revolutionary War, and they basically, the British were like the Americans, and I thought the Revolutionary War was fought with the Americans using guerrilla tactics.
Well, that wasn't the way Washington fought the war, but it was the way people like Thomas Sumter and Francis Marion fought the war. They would engage in hit-and-run tactics on British outposts, and then they'd fade away. But the war itself was primarily won by set-piece tactics in battles that any European would have recognized. So with Sumter and Marion in the Carolina Gamecock.
Francis Marion, right?
Yeah. Andrew Pickens was another one. They only used those tactics when absolutely necessary.
Okay.
But everybody figured that if the war was ever going to be won at all, it was going to have to be won with traditional set-piece battles, like Yorktown, eventually, and Cowpens and Guilford Courthouse. Those were traditional battles. Yes, go ahead.
When they took the Seminoles and sent them off to Arkansas and Oklahoma, what did they do with the blacks?
Oh, good question.
With the Seminoles, and how did they determine who was a black? Because I'm sure there was intermarriage.
Yeah. Yes, well, that is a question that remains a live question to this day, here in 2019. So that one part of the answer is that some of the black Seminoles were removed to Arkansas and Oklahoma. Some of them lived as free people there. And some of them, however, were not removed. They were re-enslaved. It just depends upon the circumstances and really the prevailing opinion of whomever was going to be taking you into captivity. It was rather arbitrary on what was going to happen to you. The rule among the Seminoles is that those who went to Oklahoma, the black Seminoles were arranged into two separate bands. There are two separate bands of free black Seminoles whose descendants live in Oklahoma, and they're considered part of the Seminole Nation. But the tricky part is that when the time came to compensate the Seminoles for the land that was taken from them after the Treaty of Moultrie Creek, the only people who got money were people who could show that they were Seminoles as of 1823. That was difficult for some of the black Seminoles to show. Some of them were there by then, but they weren't considered members of the full Seminole bands, or else they had arrived in Florida after that. So I don't think they share in the settlement, which is a matter of some grievance for them. And the other thing is that as far as the way the US government defines the Seminoles, I think the rule is that you've got to have one quarter Seminole blood, that is native Seminole blood. And if you're a black Seminole, maybe you can't necessarily show that. So there's some dispute to this day about what counts as a Seminole. But in Oklahoma, there's a rule, you're a member of the Seminole bands. There are 20 separate Seminole bands, and black Seminoles have two of them. But in Florida, it's a little bit different. There, whatever benefits go to the Seminoles don't necessarily go to black Seminole encampments in Florida. So they're still arguing about that to this day, what counts as a Seminole.
when Andrew Jackson went in to get the runaway slaves, he sent them all back into slavery?
Well, those he could find, yes. Hundreds of them. I don't know exactly how many, but hundreds of them. Now, there has another hand. Yes?
I was going to say, in hindsight, looking back on this war, it really, when we look at it today, it just seems morally offensive.
Well, yeah.
When we look at it,
well, a lot of Americans at the time thought so.
Yeah.
Well, it has a lot in common with Vietnam, I think.
Yeah.
Because you had to think of yourself as the average American in Boston or New York. Is this the kind of war that's commensurate with the high ideals as a people? So you see, Seminoles fighting for their freedom, and we're contesting that only because a few people lost cattle and because Southern slave owners are worried about this as a refuge for escaped slaves. Is this the kind of war that we should feel good about? And many Americans didn't feel good about it at all. And it cost $40 million. So, but like I said, most expensive of all the Indian wars. And people don't feel any better about it today. It was never a war that you could really justify on moral grounds very easily. Yeah?
Going back to the question about guerrilla warfare, I think in this part of the country, we're a little bit overcome by the fact that initially in 1775, that's what we did here, you know, behind stone walls and trees. And that was it, though, as far as guerrilla warfare.
Yeah. But all the characteristics for a successful guerrilla war, I think, were mastered by General Armistead back then. And he had no instruction on this at West Point. They didn't teach guerrilla tactics at West Point. I don't know when they started doing that, but it wasn't in the 19th century. So they had to make it up as they went along. Now, it's not an unpleasant way to fight a war. It's not a good thing to ask people to do, to burn crops in the ground. But if you want to destroy Indian resistance, regrettably, if that's the kind of war you've decided to fight, that's how you do it. Yes, go ahead.
You said that the Seminoles had to prove that they were original Seminoles. What was the requirement to prove that they were? I mean, we didn't have Social Security back then, so I mean, how did they prove they were?
Well, now they actually let you do DNA testing. To show that. Now there's DNA testing.
Now there is, yeah.
Now there is. Before that, I think probably a lot of Native peoples would be faced with that same problem. How would you show that you're a Seminole? I guess you had to go back to as many birth certificates as you can find, right? But there wouldn't have been that many birth certificates in the 19th century. So how would you do that? You'd have to make your case in person, probably. Maybe you know?
I don't know, but American Indians, they had records, you know, at this particular date they were signed up. Did the Seminoles have something that they were signed up a certain date that you are the Seminole, and then now they go back, and if you're not on that registry,
yeah,
you don't apply as a Seminole?
Yeah, if there is a registry, it would only date from sometime in the early 20th century, because the Seminoles who were left in Florida lived really on their own after the 1850s. They didn't have much contact with anybody else in the swamps southwest of Lake Okeechobee. So I don't think there were any records, any registry for a long time. So I'm not really sure how it would have been done, but that's a good question. Yes?
When I read that in 1920, Virginia decided anybody who had Indian blood was considered colored, except for the descendants of Pocahontas.
Oh.
And one of the descendants of Pocahontas happened to be Robert E. Lee.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Proving
yeah.
The descendant of Pocahontas, you were white.
These categories are always difficult to understand. Yes?
Well, related to these categories, if the Seminoles were a mixture of tribes coming down there,
yeah, they were.
There hasn't been enough time for there to be a distinctive DNA that says you're Seminole. So what are they testing?
Well, I think probably Muskogean, Yamasean, if you can actually, yeah, going further back. Yeah. By the way, as probably many of you know, that the Seminoles were one of the very first Indian groups to build casinos and to begin making money that way. Today there are 6 Seminole reservations in Florida. They've been there since the 20th century. And there are more Seminoles in Florida now than there were in the 1830s. So that population has recovered, at least to that extent. And also, as some of you know, part of their revenue source comes from the Hard Rock Cafe. The Seminoles own the Hard Rock Cafe all across the country. Yeah, they bought it for $1 billion about 10 years ago. But so whenever you go to a Hard Rock Cafe, except for the one in Las Vegas maybe, in London. The rest of them are owned by the Seminoles. Yes, you had a question back then. Yes.
Black Indian friend, and she said that all the people who were adopted into the tribe, they become of the tribe.
Some of them were. Some of them were adopted in that way, but not all of them were. It just depended upon who you were.
You could say that they were adopted in by other people saying, but that was not accepted.
Well, it did happen on some occasions, but I'm not sure how you would tell the difference unless you had a really good oral history to back you up about what would count as a member of the tribe and what would count as an associate of the tribe, living close by, allied with the Seminoles, but still making your own decisions. It was a very complicated situation, and it's very difficult to tease out.
So people were right into the tribe.
Yeah, this, and some of them were.
Yeah. And slaves were adopted right into the tribe.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what the percentage was.
No. I'm not either.
Go ahead.
Were there debates in Congress about the righteousness of this, but also funding the...
A lot of debates about it. The Democrats wanted to continue the war, Whigs didn't like the war, thought it was a needless expense, thought it was immoral. That was a really good way to show the difference between the two parties. The Democrats always wanted to do Southern slaveholders' bidding, and that meant removing the Seminoles. And Whigs were a bit more likely to have a high moral tone about things, and so they thought about this as something that was denying our highest ideals. The war could have gone on even further, could have had a very different result had the Seminoles had the advantage that the Shawnees and the Miamis had that we saw last time, and that is direct foreign help. If the Spaniards in Cuba had been willing to supply the Seminoles more with guns, maybe even artillery, spare parts, it could have been that this would have been a more outright victory for the Seminoles. But there was just no good way to do that, partly because the U.S. Navy could always prevent anything getting into Florida. But that was something that might have made the difference. But as it was, the Seminoles probably do have some claim to being the unconquered, which is their nickname for themselves, the unconquered. And their leader was Billy Bowlegs. He eventually decided to go to Oklahoma in the 1850s, but Sam Jones never decided to go. So Sam Jones, who was about like 95 years old by the 1850s, was determined to stay, and the Seminoles who followed him stayed where they were, and that's where they were up to the present day. Their descendants are still there. Yes?
Were there a lot of, you know, you mentioned the Southern slaveholders who really had a lot of political capital.
Yes.
But I never thought of Florida as owning a lot of black slaves. Now, maybe I'm mistaken. I always think of Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia. But I never think of Florida. Did Florida have a lot of Southern slaveholders?
Yes, less of a percentage than South Carolina, Georgia, and Alabama did. To the north, yes, the panhandle was really good cotton area, so they were growing cotton on the panhandle, mostly.
The Seminoles were near there, or?
Near enough to where you could get to where the Seminoles were, if you could escape, sure.
It wasn't that big, though, a number of people.
Well, but a lot were coming from Georgia, too.
Oh, they came down.
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. And Georgia has a city called Jessup, named after General Jessup. And a lot of places in Florida, as you've keyed into by now, were named after incidents in the Seminole War. Fort Myers was named after an officer in the Seminole War. Fort Lauderdale was named after Lieutenant William Lauderdale, who fought in the Seminole War. Fort Pierce was a Seminole War installation. Gainesville, named after General Gaines. The list goes on. Taylor Creek by Lake Okeechobee. So whenever you go through Florida, there will be reminders of the Seminole War for anybody who cares to take note. Well, are we ready to go back to your parties for the afternoon? Okay. Now, next week, if we do convene, if there's no snow day for the Lunar New Year celebration, we have a very, very interesting topic that too few Americans know much about. Some of you may. But it's the Modoc War of 1873. One of the most interesting of all the conflicts with Native peoples. So that's what I'm going to talk about next time. So I hope to see you all there, and enjoy your afternoon. Thank you.